The Honourable Ruth Dyson.
That speech actually had a lot in common with the Prime Minister's State of the Nation speech. Here's the big opportunity for the Prime Minister, brand new in his job, to make his mark, to identify the issues that face New Zealand and say what he's going to do about it. But instead of that, the Prime Minister totally ignored the housing crisis, just didn't rate a mention, didn't mention the huge financial stress that is on the education sector and now is being passed on to parents, and didn't acknowledge the underfunding in the health system. In the same way, Alfred Narro, brand new minister, his chance to make his mark in this portfolio, hardly mentioned the bill. It didn't get a mention until 4 minutes into a 5.5 minute speech in a 10 minute call. I would really encourage the new minister, and I want to congratulate him, to get a bit more on top of his portfolio and put some passion and energy into it so it makes it look like you wanted the job. It didn't really look like you wanted the job at all. I want to also acknowledge the former minister who has shepherded this bill through the House since it was split off from the Statutes Amendment Bill. The Honourable Joe Goodhue did a lot of good work in this space, and I just want to acknowledge that as well. Mr Speaker, this bill started off as part of a Statutes Amendment Bill, and it had one controversial piece. It was part three, I think, of the Statutes Amendment Bill. It had one controversial issue in it. And so in the view of the Government Administration Committee, it didn't meet the criteria for a Statutes Amendment Bill, so we did the right thing and took it out. We did another right thing at the Government Administration Committee, which was to say that it wasn't our intention, by taking it out of the Statutes Amendment Bill, to delay its progress. We didn't have any difficulty with the policy that was included in that section. It's just that because it was policy and because it was controversial, it didn't meet the criteria for Statutes Amendment, so we took it out, and it's become the Charities Amendment Bill, which we're now seeing through its third reading. I want to acknowledge the community and voluntary sector, and particularly commend them on the way that they tried to explain to the officials, and certainly strongly presented to the Select Committee, their concerns about the one controversial part. This is a sector that is clearly under pressure. They didn't come along to the Select Committee to moan about it, but it was obvious from the information that we gathered as part of our deliberation that this sector has actually been ignored by the government and I think treated in a really poor way. The new minister quite correctly acknowledged the contribution that volunteers make in our community. New Zealand would not be the country it is, and we're all really proud of it, if it wasn't for volunteers. They should be not just acknowledged but properly recognised for the contribution they make. And many of the volunteers work in the community and voluntary sector, obviously. But a large number of those organisations also have contracts with government departments, and they're no longer treated as partners in delivery of service. They're treated as somebody at the other end of a contract. And I don't think that's the New Zealand way. I don't think that's the way that we should work with organisations in our community. On a competitive tendering, short-term contract, you're just the signature at the bottom of the page sort of relationship, and that's what the National Party has done. We also learned of a state of the sector survey that had been done by ComVoices last year. They said in the survey, they told us that 65% of organisations in the community and voluntary sector have more work now than they did 2 years ago, but only 34%, so quite a big difference, 34% of them have more staff. So you have the same number of people doing a huge amount more than they did just a couple of years ago. That's not good if you're talking about a respectful relationship, if you're talking about working in partnership. 68% of the sector are required to do more work than is actually outlined in their contracts. The job wouldn't be done unless they did more, but it's not in their contract, and therefore it doesn't attract any funding to support that work. And of course, one of the first acts of the incoming National Government in 2008 was to scrap the 100% funding of our social service sector. That was in the 2008 budget. It had 4 years of money rolled out. Paula Bennett, as the incoming minister, scrapped that fund. And so the social service agencies no longer are on a path to 100% funding and haven't been for nearly 9 years. Why did the National Party do that? Because they wanted to give tax cuts to the highest income earners in New Zealand. That was the choice. Fully fund in their contract social service agencies or give tax cuts to the highest income earners. And John Key and Bill English chose tax cuts for the highest income earners. Our social service agencies, our community and voluntary sector agencies are still struggling as a result of that. The financial pressures were also outlined in the survey that I just mentioned, Mr. Speaker. 42% of organisations in the community and voluntary sector were unable to offer any staff increases in the last 2 years because of the pressure on funding that I just mentioned. So 42% gave nobody any increase in their wages. That doesn't seem to be fair. Are they not working hard enough? Don't they deserve it? Well, of course, the answer to that is of course they're working hard, and yes, they do deserve it, but the organisations just don't have the money to put in. 2% of those organisations are facing imminent closure, and over 40% were worried about their future financial viability. So the Minister, Alfred Naro, can talk all he likes about working in partnership and being respectful and thinking highly of volunteers, but the money has to go where the mouth is, Mr. Naro. You have to put your funding and resources behind your contracts, behind the work that you are requiring of organisations to deliver if you expect them to continue to do it. Mr. Speaker, back to my final points on the bill. The bill, I think, gives better protection so that people who have been convicted of a tax evasion or a similar offence under the Tax Administration Act cannot be an officer of a charitable entity. That's been a gap in the legislation and one that Labor totally supports filling. If an applicant doesn't respond to a request for information or some sort of notice from the Chief Executive when they've applied for registration as a charity, so they don't front up with the information that's requested, that application lapses. And the contentious part that I will just mention is whether the Chief Executive or the Board make decisions that can then be appealed by the charitable entity. That proposed change in Section 61 was the one that was struck out. All the other changes that are in this, possibly they would have met the criteria for a statutes amendment, but I actually think that we've had a very worthwhile debate by separating that bill out and having it run as an individual bill. We called for submissions. We didn't receive a large number. They were all entirely focused on the controversial issue and all adamantly opposed it. I regret that despite the best urgings of the Select Committee, we weren't able to get the officials and the representatives of the sector to talk for long enough together to get agreement. That perhaps it's just not possible because there's quite a fundamental disagreement about the interpretation of the law and how it was originally drafted and whether the intent was represented in that original drafting or whether in fact it was an error. Regardless, we've worked our way through. I think we showed respect to the sector as they made their submissions, and I think we've returned this bill in a much better state than it was at the beginning. So I'm pleased that we did that work. I'm pleased to be able to support the bill, and I commend its progress through to its final stage. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Paul Foster Bell.